right. I am a bit late to the party with this guy. If he is a party, I don't know. We'll see. But let us take a look at Magmatron from the Beast Wars universe. I have said this, I think, in other videos, but I don't have any nostalgia or connection to the Beast Wars universe at all. I had phased out of Transformers by the time that rolled around and just couldn't wrap my head around it. Still really can't. And believe me, I've tried from time to time, but I can't fully get on board with my robots transforming into animals with like organic material on the top of them. Forgive me. But anyway, I picked this guy up. Really, he's an impulse buy. I love the box art. I love the colors. There is something super 90s about all of this, which in 2024, the 90s are now, they're now a piece of pop culture history that it's not a far cry for me to find some nostalgia with some of the aesthetics and art choices and color palettes. It's only after the fact that I've discovered that this guy was originally released, the G1 version or whatever you want to call it, was released in 1999. So he's not exactly 90s. He's barely that. But anyway, he's interesting because of that aspect, because I like the colors. It looks 90s to me. I will always be a big fan of dinosaurs and prehistoric life. So I do enjoy the three beast modes that combine to form Magmatron. And I also just kind of enjoy that we have this kind of commander class tier of figures from Hasbro. But that's about it. I'm not going into this with any other... I'm not going into this thinking I'm going to love this figure. It really is just like a morbid curiosity mixed with a little bit of colorful box art that caught my eye. But yeah, so... Oh, before we get this out of the box, I'll also let you know I don't know much about the character. I do my videos because of nostalgia purposes, not because I'm a historian when it comes to the mythology of some of this stuff, especially Beast Wars stuff. All I know is Magmatron was the big baddie of the Japanese version of Beast Wars. And that's all I know. So, with that out of the way, let us get him out of the box. And this guy is, in a word, nuts. Nuts. He's nuts. He's pretty cool. He's nuts. All right, let's talk about him. So right out of the packaging, he comes in his combined mode, which is really impressive, and looks a lot better in person than it did in production stills, in my opinion. And he's, and of course, I mean, because what you're paying for, this commander class should be sort of like beefier, and he is. Not only is he like a chunky figure, even though he's got stuff coming off of him in all different directions, he's got some weight to him, which I really do appreciate considering the trend of Transformers getting more hollow and lighter and cheaper as time goes on. But... wow. Yeah, he's a very, very impressive combined mode. The head sculpt is really, really nice, kind of menacing. Because of the way he all fits together, I think the head only rotates. Yeah. But whatever, it's not like... with all these little bits and pieces pouring off of him, it's not like you can get him into the most dynamic poses without something butting up into something else. You can see the Elasmosaurus head on this side, the Giganotosaurus head on this side. I can't say the name of the flying guy. It begins with a Q. But it all integrates in a wacky yet satisfying way. All the articulated joints are there. But again, how are you going to get this guy into dynamic poses? I have no idea. For me, he's just going to stand statically and just look regal as can be. Some of these bits, I don't know if it's part of his, like, official combined mode. I just have sort of, like, the Giganotosaurus tail just sticking straight out. I don't know if that's what it's supposed to do.
I love that the bottom part of the Elasmosaurus is like a shield. Ah, there's just so much going on. It's very, very busy, and nothing about him is boring. And that's, I guess that's the best kind of compliment I could give a subline of Transformers that I really have no stock in. I have no nostalgia for it. Like I said, I didn't grow up with these guys. He's just fun and colorful. He does come with a bunch of the pew-pew blast effects, as well as these two swords. Yeah, really, really nice detailed work. The molding, the paint is sufficient. His sword is a softer plastic that fits into a piece that's sort of like a collapsible. It looks like the hide of the one of the dinosaurs. We'll see how that all works once I get this guy transformed. The Elasmosaurus bottom half. I like how the flippers are articulated, but they, one does something to the other. Or maybe not. Never mind. The hands, the thumb is articulated, and the other four fingers are one big piece. You've got all the movement you'd expect to have in the, in all joints, except again, a lot of things get in the way when you're trying to pose this guy. Anyway, let's get this guy into his three beast modes and take a look at those. And I can say that Magmatron even shines in the three separate prehistoric modes. So let's talk about those. And I always have to give this disclaimer that I'm not a fan of modern day Transformers toys because of how overly complicated the transformations are and simultaneously have become really, really finicky these days. These guys are not bad as far as that kind of finicky transformation goes, but they're still a headache. So I don't film my transformations, like the process of transforming them, because that would be like a 3-hour video and I don't have the time or the patience to edit it to make it not look like I'm an idiot who can't figure this stuff out. Everything fits together snugly once it gets there, but the process has me, with New Age Transformers toys, the process has me almost giving up at least 2 or 3 times throughout the process. So whatever, I just bypass all that. Here they are in dinosaur mode. So first off, because I did him first because I was most excited about his dinosaur form, is the Elasmosaurus. AKA like the Plesiosaur, AKA Loch Ness Monster, which all the panel lines are, I mean, they're all obvious, but at the same time, they're smooth and they're tight along one another. So I'm happy with that. There is a lot of points of articulation along the neck. 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 ball joints, as well as swivel joints. All the dinosaurs have articulated jaws. The flippers, the front flippers have two joints. The back flippers have one. The tail is not articulated, but nor should it be. This is a solid Elasmosaurus. Next up we have, ready? Quetzalcoatlus. That is my feeble attempt at pronouncing the name of this prehistoric bird. That's my one attempt at it. I'm not doing it again. This guy is the simplest of the three, and he's the smallest, so it makes sense. He's not overly engineered, which I'm actually kind of happy about. He houses the head, which is in the body there, so he's important. He also has an articulated jaw, some nice sculpting and some nice like paint gradient work on the wings. The wings articulate one, two, three different points of articulation, not counting the little claws on the wings. The legs, four points of articulation on the legs. There's not much you're gonna do with this guy, but he still manages to be fairly poseable. And lastly, we have the Giganotosaurus, who is kind of a goofy proportioned dinosaur, but I love him nonetheless. He's got almost like a raptor kind of proportion. Giant feet, big bulky legs. The panel lines are the most obvious of the three on him, and it's also because of the way I know the transformation takes place, because there's a separate piece that closes up the undercarriage, which is a little awkward the way it all fits into place. There are some robot bits, obviously. Obvious on the back of the legs. The tail is also completed with the sword piece. That's the more malleable rubber that fits in there. The legs are fairly articulated at the hip, the knee, double knee and the ankle. The ankle tilt is really, really nice and necessary for posing. His slightly undersized head is still nicely detailed enough. The jaw opens, not much though, unless I'm missing something or something's hitting something else. So he's the heftiest. Well, maybe he's not. Maybe the Elasmosaurus is. The Elasmosaurus is definitely my favorite of the three. Also, just because I never thought I'd get prehistoric aquatic transformer that I liked, so I'm happy with that. So yeah, overall, Magmatron is better than what I had hoped for, and maybe that's partially because I had no expectations. Like, again, this was an impulse buy. I have no attachment to Beast Wars or this whole subdivision of mythology with Transformers, but I'm really, really happy with him thus far. He does have one more trick, which is a sort of a blended beast mode of the three, called like a chimera mode, which I'm going to try to figure out now and show you him next. And here is the combined chimera mode, and it's something. It's something. That's all I can say about it. I honestly don't have an opinion on this yet. I think it might take me some time to decide what I think about this. But it is cool that you have this other weird combined mode for these guys. And that is just a quick look at Magmatron.